Blessed Memorial Day weekend to all of you. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, today is the last in our series on Easter appearances, because next Sunday is Pentecost, and today we're celebrating what actually happened Thursday, at least in terms of the church calendar, which is the Ascension. Before we look at today's text, though, let me briefly mention the other Easter appearances that we didn't have time to talk about. There was the continuation of last Sunday's fishing encounter, where Jesus and Peter have a lengthy conversation over a number of different things. That might have been the same appearance to Peter that Paul mentions in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 5, or it's possible that there was another one in there that the Bible doesn't detail. At the end of the Gospel of Matthew is an appearance on a mountain to the 11 disciples, where he gave them what's known as the Great Commission. Now, my guess is that's part of the Ascension appearance that we're talking about today. But it's possible that it was a different one. Matthew doesn't mention the Ascension because he chose to end his gospel with the Great Commission. Paul also tells us of two more appearances, but gives no details. He said that Jesus appeared to more than 500 believers at the same time. And then on a different occasion, he appeared to James, probably Jesus' brother, James. And finally, sometime after Pentecost, Jesus appeared to Paul personally on the road to Damascus, as is recorded in Acts chapter 9. Now, that's a lot of eyewitnesses. When you add in not only those, but the ones that we've been talking about for the last 6 weeks. If you were an attorney trying to litigate a case, you'd think you'd died and gone to heaven if you had that many eyewitnesses. Our faith is still faith, meaning that it can't be proven, but there is a heaping mound of evidence to support what we believe. We really have four texts that we can draw from in talking about the last appearance before Jesus ascended back into heaven. As I mentioned, I believe the end of Matthew, the Great Commission, is probably the same time frame as the Ascension, even though he stops with the Great Commission. Matthew 28:17 says that they worshiped him there on the mountain, even though some of them doubted. What a tremendous encouragement that little verse is, on a couple of different levels. First, even though the disciples had seen Jesus alive after the resurrection, they'd eaten with him, they'd seen the scars in his hands and in his feet, even still, they wrestled with doubts. So whenever you're struggling with doubts, know that you've got really good company. Second, even though they doubted, it says they still worshiped Jesus. Doubt and worship belong together. We can still bow the knee, literally and figuratively, even when we're struggling in our faith. In fact, the best place to be when we're struggling is with a community of believers, because their faith can help lift ours when ours is beleaguered. A second text that deals with the Ascension is the longer ending to the Gospel of Mark. We won't have time to study that one today, but you're invited to look it up for yourself. A third Ascension text is the end of Luke, which we read earlier, and then finally Luke's sequel, Acts, which we also read earlier, overlaps the ending of Luke with another text about the Ascension. We're going to concentrate today on those two, the end of Luke and the overlapping beginning of Acts. In Luke, Jesus makes a point of telling the disciples more than once that everything written about him in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. When you read the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms, that's another way of saying the Old Testament. The New Testament hadn't been written yet, so it wouldn't have been referred to as the Old Testament. It would have been called the Scriptures. There's continuity between the revelation of God in the Old Testament and the revelation of God in the New Testament. Now, it's absolutely true that we look at all of Scripture through the lens of Jesus, because Jesus is the Word of God in the flesh. He's the clearest picture that we have. So when we look at the Scriptures, we look at the whole thing through the eyes of Jesus. But Jesus did not come on the scene and say, out with the old, in with the new. Rather, he fulfilled the old, the promises and the prophecies that had been collected over the previous few millennia. Be wary of someone who claims a new revelation that has no connection with the past. God clears up a lot of things in Jesus, but he doesn't do an about-face and contradict everything that had come before him. The old covenant and the new covenant are connected. They're not the same, and thank God for the new covenant, but neither are they unrelated. Now, in more than one of the Easter appearances, it says that Jesus spent time going through the Scriptures with the disciples, opening their minds to understand what was there. In those appearances, in those 40 days between Easter and the Ascension, you know that Jesus was only going to focus on what was most important. And so when it says more than once that he opened up the Scriptures with them to understand, to help them understand what was there, if ever there was a good reason and motivation for Bible study, that's got to be it. If Jesus spent time with the disciples opening up the Word to them, then certainly we want to be in the Word doing the same thing, having Jesus open up our minds to understand as well. Reading the Bible on your own and reading it with others is another both and. When we read it on our own, we can hear God speaking to us personally, highlighting specific verses that we read so that we can apply them to what's going on in our own daily lives. The soaping method that many of you use is an excellent way of doing that. But we also want to read the Bible with others because they'll see things that we miss and vice versa. Reading the Bible with others helps protect us from going off the rails in our interpretation of Scripture. The end of the Gospel of Luke summarizes the Gospel this way. The Christ, the Messiah, Jesus, will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. The Gospel starts with the historicity of Jesus. Jesus the Messiah really came, really died on the cross, and really rose from the dead, like we've been talking about these last several weeks. Those are historical events, and we can examine them through the sciences of archaeology and the study of ancient writings. But the gospel isn't only a reciting of history. Repentance and forgiveness of sins in Jesus' name is what personalizes the gospel. Each of us repent of our own sins, and each of us can experience forgiveness in deeply personal ways. The last words of Jesus in Luke are these: I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high. Both parts of that sentence are referring to the Holy Spirit, what would happen 10 days after the ascension on Pentecost. Jesus and the Father promised to send the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is power from on high. I think it's a little bit humorous that Jesus so clearly instructs the disciples to wait for the Holy Spirit. Don't go try this on your own, he's saying. Because we've seen what happens when you do that. It doesn't work out well. Wait, and you'll know when you've been equipped with the Holy Spirit. So that's where Luke ends. Let's look at the overlapping story of the ascension in the sequel, the book of Acts. Acts 1:3 says this, after his suffering, meaning the crucifixion, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. Jesus is thoroughly consistent. The kingdom of God was his first focus, and it was his last focus as well. Mark's first recorded words of Jesus are, the time has come, the kingdom of God is near, repent and believe the good news. And that's very similar to what we just heard as the summary of the gospel that happens at the end of Jesus' life. In between, many of Jesus' parables are taught about the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God is simply wherever Jesus has power and authority and influence. Then verse 4 says, on one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you've heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Two things are worth noting, both of which we've already mentioned. The comment that he was eating with them is yet another reminder that Jesus was really present, not a ghost, and not merely resurrected faith, as some would have you believe. Jesus' body was resurrected, and he ate with them. And secondly, Acts repeats the reminder that the disciples were told very specifically to not try to do this on their own strength, but to wait for the Holy Spirit. Verse 6 lets us know once again how fallible the disciples are. They ask Jesus, after all of that, so is this when you're going to kick out the Romans and Israel gets to have its kingdom back? And Jesus is like, after all that I've taught you, about the kingdom of God, you still think it's an earthly kingdom with power here on earth. I think the biggest risk that God takes is in entrusting the kingdom of God to us. Despite all of our doubts and all of our mistakes and all of our misunderstandings. And yet he consistently does in every generation. He leaves us the Holy Spirit so that we're not on our own to figure things out, but we're still responsible to rely on the Holy Spirit. We still have the free will to foolishly choose to operate out of our own strength and understanding instead of relying on the Holy Spirit. Jesus answers their question by simply saying, it's not for you to know. Israel will be restored, but it's not for you to know when that'll happen. And then the Great Commission gets repeated. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. The book of Acts follows that outline perfectly. It starts with the disciples witnessing to Jesus in Jerusalem. Then they move to neighboring states of Judea and Samaria, and then finally to missionary travels to neighboring countries. Then Jesus ascends into heaven right before their eyes. Two angels appear and reassure the disciples that Jesus will return at some point in the future to earth. We're still eagerly awaiting Jesus' return 2,000 years later. The scriptures teach us that Jesus is waiting until every nation on earth, every people group, has had a chance to hear the good news of Jesus. Now, before we close, we have to ask the question, why did Jesus have to leave? Right? Why couldn't he have just stayed here with us in his eternal resurrected body? You ever wonder that? Well, Jesus tells us why. He said over in John 16, which was Thursday before Easter, "It's for your good that I'm going away, because unless I go, the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, will not come to you." Do you remember from a few weeks ago the definition of the Holy Spirit? All the power of Jesus and all the presence of Jesus made personal. Three P's, easy to remember. All the power of Jesus and all the presence of Jesus made personal. As long as Jesus was in a body, his presence was limited to one place at a time. But when Jesus pours out his Holy Spirit on us, which John described as Jesus' breath, he's even more present with us now than he was with the disciples then. He indwells us now. He's in here, in our hearts, through the power of the Holy Spirit. And he indwells every single believer simultaneously. What a great gift, and the subject of next Sunday, Pentecost. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for giving so many convincing proofs that you had risen from the dead. We thank you for opening the minds and the eyes of the disciples to your holy scriptures, to your word. And we thank you that you can do that for us too. And finally, we thank you that you did ascend back into heaven so that we could receive the Holy Spirit and operate with all of your power and all of your presence on a personal level, each and every one of us. Lord Jesus, help us to rely firmly on your Holy Spirit today and every day until you return. In your name, Jesus, we pray.